Okay, number of guests, 6. Okay, perfect. I'll drop it down to 4. Hey, everybody. I'm just starting this now. So, I mean, obviously, I said it was going to be quarter to. Damn, y'all already throwing likes in there. Victoria, what'd you do? You went to Zoom looking for a link? I'm gonna finish up something here, work related, but I'm gonna go ahead and take care of this. Give people a little bit of time to jump in here. Let's see if I can get a what's it called? The shit. An IP infraction. I'll just put this on. Friday, September 1st, 15 students. This old town can slow me down. People take the easy way. I know we don't have. Victoria, do not feel weird about that. This is part of the process. Like, you got to understand that, like, education itself should be about lifelong learning. It's not about I graduated, I'm done. Like, if not you, I'm saying in for example, anybody, or if you were to say something like, I've got my degree, I'm done reading, I'm done doing this, like, you're doing a disservice to yourself by doing that. Because my kid will often ask me, like, which I'm still in school. I'm finishing my doctorate. So she'll ask me all the time, like, why are you doing this? Why are you reading this? Why are you doing that? And my argument is always like, you should always be learning something. You should always be working towards something. And not always to an end like a degree, but you'd always be learning something to better yourself. You know, if, like this class that I was teaching for about 9 years, and I guess now 10 years since I'm doing it here for all of you, was like my favorite class to teach, not because I'm a film lover and a lover of pop culture, but because there's so much that goes into representative art like this. Thought I was going to pull up the whole soundtrack, but... Let's see. Let me pull up one of these other ones. So, yeah, you can't look at education as like I'm done, because the moment you're done, you may as well be dead. Because one of the things I wanted to do aside from what I'm doing now is learn something that's out of my wheelhouse, you know. Zora, there's nothing weird about doing that. I'm one of those people who held those public lectures. So I've held too many. I held one about this film. I did some about Birth of a Nation, both films, the earlier one, as well as the Nat Turner version. Get Out, we did a film discussion about that with a community. We called them community dialogues. So it was a lecture, but you got to hear from people who were in their field to talk about issues regarding race, gender, labor, different historical moments, sociological issues. And it was always good to, you know what I'm going to, Crazy Fox, what I'm going to do is I'm going to once it's eligible for me to download, I'll go ahead and put it online on YouTube, and I'll just put a link on here once I figure out how to do all that. That way you at least have some of that stuff that you can go back to. And so what I'll let everybody know as they're coming on here, I mean, you're doing social media in the first place, so you've already consented in so many ways. But for anybody who wants to participate, there has to be this understanding, like this is going to be put up for other people to view, to listen to. So I'll do my 15 to 20 minutes, and as you see, you've got like the four boxes. So I'm going to open up those boxes for other people to engage in the discussion, and I will just serve as moderator and interlocutor, where I'm asking those questions, discussing, helping the conversation continue. And then after that, I'll bring in another four people. Hopefully it's productive. Hopefully we don't have anybody here who has some malintentions. But you never know with a live, because there's often sometimes people who jump on and they have nothing better to do than just, I guess, just troll for lack of better term. So we got a few more minutes. You mean you don't have live access to jump? Is it a follower thing? Oh, how can you? Can I invite you? I can't even do that. Let me see. Let me put the. Oh, King Dan, we're not doing that just yet. When we have that. Oh, shoot. Push the wrong button. See, where were you on here? Let's see if I can put you on here, Zora. Damn, it will not let me add you. That is wild. All right. As I've done before, I'm just going to go ahead and in these 5 minutes that we have before any more people jump in, because I think like 300 people registered for this. I don't know why. I'm just me. What I'm going to do, oh, shoot, I'm pushing the wrong stuff here. So with this, actually, let me see if I can lower this some more so my head is up there as opposed to. Let's see if I can find the tripods I have. And of course, I can't. Bear with me here for a second. Might be a little bit better. All right, so let me go back. Yeah, that sounds about right. As far, and it also seems like you have to have a certain number of followers in order to do it in the first place. But like I said, what I will do to start off while people continue to jump in, because last time I looked, it was like 300 people who had registered for the event, and I'm going to give them some time because they may have just planned on it starting at 6. I said 5:45 because I wanted to go ahead and have a little bit of some chit chat time. It was typically what I had with my students. A few minutes before class, we would catch up, we'd talk about stuff, and then we would get into the course. So, for those of you who don't know, my name is Don. I am a historian. For the last 9 years, I should say from 2013 to 2022, I was a history instructor at Arizona State University. My courses focused on race, gender, ethnicity, pop culture. One of my staple classes, and I mean staple as far as like it was full every semester. Couple of semesters I had to add extra sections of it, was film as history. And the dropout rate for that course was very low. I probably on average maybe lost one or two students, because there may have been some students who jumped in the class because they thought, oh, cool, we're going to get to watch movies like, you know, coach showed us in high school. That's just a small dig at the field of social studies. We're going to watch these films and there's really going to be nothing about it. We're just going to just watch movies. But as the students looked at the syllabus, now, of course, I only counted students after they got the syllabus. I had some students who would jump out of the course because they saw the syllabus and they saw there was a lot of reading. And it wasn't just movies, but I love teaching that course. And I hope to, when I go back on the market, once I finish up my doctorate, that I can take that same course, whether I have to rebuild it or I just take the stuff that I have already and use it wherever I happen to be, whoever picks me up. And again, that was a staple course that started off well and ended well when I was there. I don't even know if anybody still teaches the course, but it was a great way to break my students into understanding. Oh, I do. This is just the first session. So what I would do, what I had with my students, at least the relationship that was developed was, the ability for them not to look at historical films. I've just got a few months for them to look at their historical films, but realize that the number one way that people consume history is through films. It's not through monographs as far as historical research documents, as far as books. It's not through articles. That's something that's reserved more for people in the field. I can't do my job by just watching movies about history because there's so much that goes into the making these films. There's so much that's done for creative. Oh, trust me, we're gonna throw down when that happens. I already have the TikTok planned as far as what I'm gonna do. But when it comes to the films themselves and understanding exactly what role they play, they can be very damaging. They can be very damaging to the point where they kind of destroy our historical memory. And our historical memory is this collective understanding, this collective narrative of what took place in history. Sometimes that narrative needs an adjustment. Sometimes that narrative needs to be completely destroyed and rebuilt. One of the things I will use as an example would definitely be like the Daughters of the Confederacy, the way that they were able to teach and misteach history. Teach and misteach history for generations. And what they've done, I mean, irreparable damage is one way of saying it. I would just say they completely just propagandized generations of people, myself included, because I went to school where they still had heavy influence as far as what was being taught, what was in the books, what was in the curriculum. Film has a lot more freedom, though. So you will have movies where people will hire historians to do the research, and then they will use the historians in order to help tell that narrative that they want to have out there. So a film like Princess and the Frog, Disney got its ass kicked over a movie like Pocahontas because of what it portrayed. It still portrayed a lot of the indigenous stereotypes. It still did not present indigenous America is something that didn't rely on mysticism and these relations that they had to the land. Like, they trivialized a lot of things. And one of the videos I made, or maybe the live I made last Tuesday, discussed this, where they were able to get away with it at the time because people weren't as aware of what was taking place with indigenous communities, you know, with the Carlisle schools, the Indian trade schools, things like that. The rules when it came to living on the reservation. So they didn't they didn't have anybody that they had to fight against, except for Native American activists. So indigenous activists, people like Russell Means, couldn't come out against the movie because they gave him a job with the movie. They hired Russell Means to play Mataqua's father, the chief of the Powhatan. So that voice that you hear in the film where he stands up right before they have the song about savages, savages. I can't remember how the whole song goes, but you have the Europeans that are calling the indigenous folks savages, and you have the indigenous folks calling the European savages. So they have this medley that's going on. But there's this one point where Russell Means's character, the chief, says these white men are dangerous, right? So for him, that was great because he got to say that line in a Disney movie, and that was stuff that he was saying 30 years prior at the Second Battle of Wounded Knee. But a movie like Princess and the Frog comes along, you now are going to have to be a lot more conscious of what you're talking about, how you're addressing race, how you're addressing racism, how you're addressing sexism, how you're addressing the history of this period. And Disney does a lukewarm job of it in this film. Now, granted, their job, filmmakers, especially for Disney, their job is to make money, it's not to educate. Their job is to take the information that's there and create a product from it. So for a movie like Princess and the Frog, you're getting to see 1912 through the 1920s. And you're getting a Disney lens about what life was like for this one black girl and then this one black woman when she gets older, what it was like for them in New Orleans. They don't make things race neutral. They don't make issues to where you can completely ignore the concept of racism. It becomes kind of this subtext that's allowed in the film. So you've got themes of race, gender, and class that are thrown all into this film. And these two things I want you to be aware of if you haven't been exposed to them before are these two terms, new woman and new Negro. So the new woman is something of the 1920s. It's these women that are now going to college, they're getting jobs, they're driving cars. They're like, think about how rebellious something like driving a car is. Think about it. You don't look at it as, you don't look at driving a car as this act of rebellion. But in the 1920s, not that Tiana does this, but that's just an aspect of the new woman. Playing sports, going to school, starting your own business, getting the right to vote, because that was something that takes place prior to Tiana's, I'm sorry, during Tiana's transformation from childhood to adulthood. Now women have the right to vote. So all these aspects of the new woman are being presented in this film. And something that's not included, which I thought would have been cool to have, whether she was in human form or in frog form, was to have her driving a car, because that is a revolutionary act in the 1920s for women. The act of simply driving a car threatens so many men, because if you are a woman who can drive a car, you can go somewhere without depending on a man. If you're a woman who can drive a car, you can be alone with your lover. So that was one of the fears that people had about women going off to college, women getting jobs, women smoking, which again, it's a Disney movie, so your princess is not going to be smoking, and women drinking. This film does a good job of presenting some things that people thought, yeah, this is prohibition, because it's 1920s, the majority of the time that you're watching this film. It's prohibition. There shouldn't be an alcohol. Two things about that. One, people were still drinking during Prohibition. And two, it was New Orleans. If there's one thing that flows in Louisiana, and especially New Orleans, it's alcohol. It does not matter who you are, who you know, you are going to be able to get something to drink, and especially somebody like Big Daddy. So Big Daddy was a sugar baron. I'm sorry, I just saw your thing, Candace, about talking about me on a podcast. Look, podcast bros can't touch me, because they're worried about puffing out their chest and being alphas and stuff like that. So you had people like Big Daddy in this film, played by John Goodman. Like, there was no better person to play this character than him. So as a sugar baron, Now, mind you, one of the most popular drinks that you make out of sugar, oh, you can't see it, is rum. And rum and bourbon, as well as a few other alcohols themselves, are favorites within the South. You're not going to stop people from drinking in the South. It ain't going to happen. Oh no, yeah, I know that study. He didn't have to go far. He didn't have to go far to find the alcohol because the police were involved, the mayor's office was involved. New Orleans was not going to shut down. You had gambling, you had prostitution, you had alcohol. Whatever vice you wanted, you were going to get it at that time. So new woman is one term. The other term, as I said or may not have said, it's the new Negro or the new Negress. This is about breaking away from those generalizations and stereotypes about black femininity. So the new Negro, it's just all encompassing as an it's an umbrella term for this new group of black people that are not born in slavery. It's this new group of people that are not feeling the direct effects of slavery. So now you have this moment in which I can go out and get a job. I can, if you can, if you have the ability to in an urban setting, get a job, get an education, raise up my family. The new Negress was the new woman, but black. So now I, as a black woman, I don't have to be a domestic. I can go to one of these HBCUs. I can go get an education. I can find some job that is going to suit me. And damn it, I don't have to marry anybody in order to have the life I want. So that focus with Tiana, because a lot of people when this movie came out, they're like, I don't get it. She just wants to be independent. She doesn't want a prince. That's one part of it. But the other issue is being the new Negress from start to finish. It is about her independence. It is about her actually asserting who she is. The reason, and not to argue with you, Lexi, the reason why they go with her as being a frog, Disney almost really messed this up because the first title was going to be The Frog Princess, not The Princess and the Frog, The Frog Princess. And she wasn't going to be a waitress, she was going to be a domestic. So she was going to be a maid. And so the first people they were talking to about this film shut it down. They said, do not portray this because it's going to be way too much like Song of the South. It's going to be way too much like all these other films that were made that ridiculed black people. The other thing is this. See, I already got y'all with that. She wasn't going to be named Tiana. Her name was going to be Maddie. And those of you who already know where I'm going with this, she was going to be a domestic named Maddie. It was going to sound just like Mammy. So all this was like on the drawing board for Disney to go with, and they immediately said, we can't do this because Disney will get killed, will get destroyed. So this wasn't the 1960s. It's not the night. Oh, I'll do guessing a little bit. Sorry. So it won't do it. You could have done this in the 50s or 60s and gotten away with it. You could have done this probably in the 70s or 80s, right? But the fact that you're doing this in what is now seen as a post-racial America, post-racial, seen in a post-racial, oh, don't worry, I'm going to get to Louis in a second. In a post-racial America, we had just elected the first black president. So do you think Disney, and since this film is already in production, is Disney going to risk when this movie comes out in 2009, are they going to risk having poor representation for African American characters in film? Disney is going to get destroyed for doing that. Like, you won't have to assemble anybody. The discussion will be, is 2009 and then going into 2010, is 2009. Why are we still making movies like this? Now, I will disagree about make well. Wait, I'm mixing people's comments up. Hold on a second. So you got the identity issues brought up in the film as far as Tiana is an independent woman. She's an independent black woman. but it's not hitting you over the head with it as far as like, hey, we're really going to hit you hard with this. We're going to destroy you. And yeah, I think that is that Lexi. Yeah, Lexi, after they kind of fumbled it with this film, but they made sure to make those corrections when they entered the Marvel Cinematic Universe and you had things like Black Panther being introduced. You were not going to mess that up. They were not going to, in fact, people that were associated with it were not going to allow it to be messed up. The opening of the film hits you with this. You have people that are living in two different worlds, two completely different worlds. So Charlotte and Tiana and Charlotte are friends because of what her mom does. Her mom is a seamstress. And she has been hired by Big Daddy to make dresses for his daughter. Otherwise, they would not be friends because when those two. Okay, cool. Enjoy yourself. you can see yourself, see yourself out of my class. That's enjoy yourself. So, children's movies. Then you obviously haven't watched enough cartoons because those are not for children. Wu-Tang is for the children. So you got two different worlds. So you have Charlotte and Tiana, right? Tiana is only friend, or excuse me, Charlotte is only friends with Tiana because of what her mother Eudora does. Eudora is a seamstress. She's making these dresses for this child, bringing good money in, right? But when they leave that house and they have that, they get on the streetcar, very subtly does Disney hit you with, hey, here's some racism. Here's some racism. Because when they get on that streetcar, they go directly to the back. And if you go back and watch the film, there are about three or four rows of seats between them and a white passenger. So when they are traveling, you start to see how she has this kid's view of like, oh my gosh, here are all the cute big houses. It's so beautiful. And then you go down that streetcar line. And you get to the shotgun shacks. So you get to see how, at least how class and race are represented. Well, it's not even the hood at that point. It's just the poorer community. It's not even a ghetto. It's a poorer community. It's a working class community. No, go back. I mean, it's like 3 minutes into the movie. It is, they go all the way to, well, I shouldn't say all the way to the back. They go near the back of the car, but there are like three or four rows of seats. Well, Plessy versus Ferguson is in the 1890s, but the streetcar laws in Louisiana, excuse me, the streetcar laws in New Orleans, I believe they don't desegregate them until the 20s, either the late teens or the early 20s, which is remarkable that train cars like or streetcars like we're not going to do this anymore. So things change. So getting on to that. We press forward as far as like you see Tiana going to bed, wishing for a better day, whatever, right? Wishing for better conditions, wishing for to be able to have that restaurant with her daddy, Tiana's place, which if I forget this, I'm going to bring it up right now. Thank you for the gifts, by the way. When they have that moment of she's talking about Tiana's place, or the dad writes down Tiana's place on the picture, in the end of the film, it's not named Tiana's place. It's named Tiana's Palace. Great way that they show kind of how she is a princess. She is valid. She's welcome, right? But for her father, James is an interesting character because I can't remember who I was talking to on here before, maybe last week or in one of the comments, that Tiana does not have her father present as an adult. She has her father very present as a child. You see the relationship that they have. He goes off to fight in World War I, and there's a very big error that they make in the film. They give James an American award. Black soldiers that went and fought in World War I got sent out to join the French troops. So if he had been something like Jeffrey Johnson, who's known as Black Death, who was one of the members of the Harlem Hellfighters, you would have gotten the Croix de Guerre. what they show Tiana's dad getting in the film, because he dies in combat, he gets the Army Distinguished the Army Distinguished Cross. That was something that black soldiers did not get until the army was desegregated. Okay, that's not for me. No, I don't think, well, him getting the award is not intentional because he could not get it. Unless it's an issue of like, we bring it back and we talk about that aspect as far as like, here's some things to correct. But that was not a medal he would have been able to get. Yeah, because that medal is typically reserved for valor and heroic acts. You know, basically, he sacrificed himself to save other people. The odds of a black soldier getting that as part of the American Expeditionary Force, slim to none. Slim to none, because black soldiers that were going to fight off in World War I were often sabotaged when it came to training. They were sent to the Deep South, and they would get into fights with the locals, or I should say the locals would sometimes attack them. There was I think there was one in Galveston. There was a massive like uprising in Galveston where the locals attacked black soldiers if they saw them off base. There were some units that weren't even given weapons. So you've got that's thrown in as well. So it's a good touch to show that her father isn't missing, didn't run away, you know, she's not an illegitimate kid. It's simply her dad busted his butt to get her in the right position. Okay, I don't know who Augustus is talking to, but her dad busted his butt to get in that position, which is what I almost said Baron Samedi, but what Dr. Facilier brings up, where he says, look how hard your daddy worked. He worked sometimes double shifts, sometimes triple shifts, and he would never let you know how hard he was working because he didn't want you to worry, as his way to kind of ploy her into giving him the amulet, right? So you're seeing that he's hard working, he's instilling this idea of hard work. This is the next thing I want you to think about. You have these two approaches. You have Booker T. Washington's accommodationist piece, which is work hard, work hard, work hard, work hard. Don't worry about political shit. Don't worry about any of that. And then you have Du Bois, who is talking about being confrontational, racial uplift, double consciousness, things like that, right? So he's talking about all those issues. I'm sorry, they're talking about all these issues in this film. So you see a Booker T. Washington approach with the father, but then you see a mix of that with Tiana. So you see the Booker T. Washington accommodationist, I gotta work hard, work hard, work hard, work hard. But then you also have that position where she's kind of like, no, I'm gonna stand up for myself, I'm gonna stand up for other people. And then you see how that starts to play around within this film. Now, Louis, I know this is why most of y'all registered, this is why most of y'all came here for this. Louis is a metaphor or an allegory about Jim Crow racism, Jim Crow America. So you have these various moments. The best ones are, I wrote it down. Here we go. I went straight to the Fenner brothers. I'm sorry. Okay. So when we get to Louis, right? All throughout the film, no, Tiana, don't. Tiana's mother, again, Tiana's mother is a domestic. She works for hire. She is a seamstress. In fact, Big Daddy refers to her as a seamstress so many times. Like, you're the best seamstress in all of New Orleans. Plus, this is 1912, so you did not have chattel slavery or legalized slavery. You had the loophole of prison, but she was not. So when Louis comes in, you see that he's quickly looking for acceptance, right? But he enters spaces where he's not welcome. When he has that story about like, oh, you know, I just want to play with the big boys. I want to play jazz. I want to do this. And he shows like he's just thinking about, I'm worth this. I'm a good musician. I should be treated accordingly, according to my talents. So I'm going to go and play. I love this music. I'm going to go play with the humans. So you see in this flashback, you know, he jokingly says it didn't end well or didn't go well, where he shows up to play this music and they immediately are fearful of him. And he gets rejected. He gets thrown out. What that is basically showing you is, especially when you couple that with the song, When I'm a Human or If I Were a Human, there's this discussion that he has about what he would be able to do. And during of course, this is a time period later. During the Harlem Renaissance in the late 20s, 30s, and 40s, it is all about equality. It is all about, you have some stories that are talking about white racism. You have these stories that are talking about going to the cotton club, but then you can't go to the cotton club unless you're a musician. And this is in Harlem. You have clubs that are racially segregated, but then you have white and black folks that want to dance and play music together and drink together in the 1920s and 30s. You have rent parties that people are throwing. But what Louis is trying to promote to you as an audience member, to us, is that he just wants to live his life. If it weren't for Jim Crow segregation, if it weren't for Jim Crow racism, he would be up there playing music. And you see that at the end of the film at Tiana's Palace, not Tiana's Place. At Tiana's Palace, he is playing in a multiracial band. And no one gives a damn about him being an alligator at that point. And that's what they're trying to get through in this film. Might be a little bit preachy, might be a little bit fun, but what they're trying to establish is there is no reason. Obviously, it's a cartoon. For there is no reason for you to fear him when all he wants to do is play music. In the late 1920s, 1930s, we had what was known as Reefer Madness. And of course, you're talking about a time period that you're capturing the 1920s, but they have 30s, 40s, and 50s influence throughout this film because they make references to stuff that's not even around. Like when she talks about her restaurant, she talks about having Bananas Foster, but I think Bananas Foster didn't come until the 30s or 40s. As well as some of the musicians that he's referencing. Some of those musicians that he references aren't even popular yet. Sidney Bechet had already been around, but when he mentions Louis Armstrong isn't that big yet. Like he's not that guy. So for him, it's an issue of moving into those spaces without the danger of being attacked. Where if you look at Jim Crow, there are parts of town you're not allowed to go to. You're supposed to get off the street. Get off the sidewalk if somebody is approaching. You're not supposed to touch hands with somebody. So what Louis is showing you for kids and for audience members is you should not treat somebody differently because they are different than you. That's what it gets down to. And the one of the redeeming moments that takes place on this film is when they sneak onto the riverboat. And they think that Louis is in a costume. They think he's in a disguise. So they immediately go like, "Hey, can you play that horn?" And he's like, "Yeah, come play with us." And you see this big alligator smile come up, and you realize like Louis is getting his dream. He's getting this point where he is being treated as an equal. Those barriers, those boundaries, those restrictions of Jim Crow are not there anymore. So now he can live as a human. You can live without these restrictions. And I want to mention this because I mentioned this in a previous live. There was a gentleman I met who was a World War II veteran. He's a Black World War II veteran. And he got to go to England right before D-Day, or was planning to participate in the D-Day launch as a quartermaster. But D-Day got moved forward. So when he got there, everybody had already left. Like the previous units had already left. He was stuck there. And Raymond's more of a cultural influence as far as like Cajun Creole, throwing that in there. Really, there's not much else going on with Ray other than he's probably one of the best characters in the film. But this gentleman, Mr. Thompson, he was talking about how he got there because he came from the Jim Crow South. And when he went to England, he got a pass and they said, "Well, we don't have anything for you to do. Here's a 3-day pass. Just go to London, take the trains, enjoy yourself while you're here because you have nothing to do." So he got on the train. There was no colored section on the train. He got off in London. There was no colored seating. There were no colored, areas for eating. And what he said to me in that moment of me talking to him, interviewing him, he said, "That was what freedom was to me. I was treated like everybody else. I was not treated differently because of my color. I was not treated differently because I was from Virginia. I was not treated differently because of my rank, because that wasn't an issue when he got there. I was treated like everybody else. That's what freedom is." So for Louis, being treated like a human for him is freedom. Being treated like a human for him is an escape from Jim Crow. It's a recognition of his talents, of his abilities, and it's not something that can be minimized into you're undeserving of this space because you are of this background or of this. It's a Disney movie. Animals talk. Like, if anybody was like, well, he's an alligator, I'm like, all the animals talk. Who cares? Yeah, and the other thing is, the goal is that people won't be able to use his outside appearance as rationale to dismiss him, which is great because anybody from a marginalized community, whether they want to admit it or not, or what some of the folks on some of these other lives want to admit it or not, who are of color, you all have those moments where you question whether or not you were treated differently because of your appearance. You were treated differently because of your gender identity, your nationality, the language that you're speaking. So you question that, and those questions come from a long history of that happening. So for Louis, again, he's not going anywhere near any of this stuff because of what has happened to him when he's tried. You try to step out of that neighborhood, you might get attacked by people in this neighborhood because they don't want people of your background, of your group there. And speaking of background, I jumped over because I went to Louis. Now, what's problematic... Why is this? Sorry, one of my. All right. So one of the things that makes this film a little bit problematic, right? And this is the biggest complaint. Tiana spends the majority of the film as a frog. Yes and no. She spends 17 minutes on camera as a human, 23 minutes as a frog. So it's almost 50-50, right? But what's more important about her, other than her turning into this frog, because with any of these movies, right, you have to have some transition, some change, something that is going to damage this something that is going to impact this person to where they kind of change their perspective about the world, where they change their perspective about what they're doing. And give me 3 minutes, and then I'm gonna turn it over to all of you. But the issue about the Fenner brothers and Realty, that is not redlining what they did. Redlining doesn't come around until the 1930s. But you could make the argument that they're talking about redlining without talking about redlining. What they're really getting into is housing discrimination, Realty discrimination, where Tiana is a single Black woman. Again, she's the new Negress. She's a single Black woman who is being independent. She's working two jobs. She's saving up everything she can to start her own restaurant. She goes to the Fenner brothers and they tell her like, oh, we'll have the papers ready for you to sign after Mardi Gras. And her response as they're driving away is, no, I'll just see you at the masquerade ball tonight and I could sign them there. I don't want to wait. I got the money. I got the deposit. We're good to go. But when they see her at that masquerade ball, there are several things you also need to notice that Disney throws in there. Aside from the band, there are no people of color at that. I'm sorry, besides people who are working, there are no people of color at that party. So you got Tiana that's serving up her beignets. You have the band and you have Dr. Facilier who snuck in. So, I mean, obviously he's not invited. But what you see is the way in which people of color are in the background, right? So when she does see them at the masquerade ball, she confronts them and they respond with, oh, about that property, you were outbid. When did we ever discuss bidding on the property? You already had your earnest money deposit, what the equivalent would be today, the earnest money deposit. But when they hit her with a little woman, little is always important. A little woman of your background would have her hands full. You're better off where you're at. That part like cuts through. I think on one of the videos, somebody mentioned when they saw it in theater, there were people laughing. I saw that part. I'm like, oh shit, we're going to get real with this movie. Disney's actually doing the right thing. They're going to talk about it. So you don't see until the end that Tiana, Naveen, and Louis She shows up with the money. So it wasn't a thing of like, you're gonna sell this to me or you're gonna give this to me. It was, here's the money that you requested for this building. I want the building. And also with Louis, you also see that issue of code switching, or at least an extent of code switching. Because Louis understands how he's perceived. As a lot of black people, a lot of indigenous folks, a lot of Latina folks, they understand how they may be perceived in those situations where they are marginalized or minoritized. So you have to, whether you're any form of minority, black, gay, trans, indigenous, Latina, Asian, you have to code switch. And so Louis code switches from being this nice smiley gator, and when the Fenner brothers are like not ready to take the money, that's when he literally shows his teeth. So he knows when he needs to turn it on and when he needs to turn it off, because these folks don't understand that Louis a good person. He's not this crazed, like even in the swamp, he's not ready to eat Tiana and Naveen like the other alligators are. But he understands exactly how people are going to see him. Tiana would still run the risk of being denied. She would still run the risk. And I'm glad you, I think this HNIC. That's one of the great things about code switching. It's all about survival. There are places where I've gone and it's simply like you can read the room and determine what version of you needs to be present. How authentic you can be in that moment. Louis is being authentic the entire film until he has to show his teeth. When he shows his teeth, that's when you're not getting him, you're getting the idea that these people have conjured up. And it's the same thing as when I was talking about jazz music in the 20s and 30s. There was this fear that you cannot, especially in mixed clubs, you are not supposed to let, because all these women are now new women, no matter if they're black, Hispanic, white, they're all considered new women because of what they want to achieve. You cannot let your young daughters, and young, I mean like 20s, you're not supposed to let your young daughters out of the house to go to a jazz club, because one of those musicians is going to get you hooked on reefer. And she's going to become a white slave. When I tell you the papers I've read about white slavery and this big fear in the early part of the 20th century is hilarious, because it's all, man, these jazz musicians are going to get these girls hooked on reefer. They're going to turn them into prostitutes. It's coming. You got to protect your daughters. So you see how that plays in as well. It's like you've got this fear of any type of mixing. Now, last thing before, yeah, because I brought that up. I mentioned code switching, but I also need to mention double consciousness. So you've got this aspect that is created and coined by W.B. Du Bois, who graduated from Fisk and Harvard University. He was a rival of Booker T. Washington. And I mentioned the whole idea of racial uplift and confrontation earlier with him. But one of the best things he came up with was this idea of double consciousness, right? And it's the idea of your race and your humanity. Like you're black and you're American. Like your race and your nationality. You're black and American. You're one and you're both. And you have to understand that. For Tiana, she has triple consciousness. She's an American, black, and she's a woman. So she has to deal with those hurdles, those extra things that she has to deal with. And one of the themes that's attributed to her throughout this film is you have to work twice as hard. You have to work twice as hard to get just the bare minimum. So you got a class issue, you got a labor issue. You also have this conflict between her and her friend Charlotte, where Charlotte gets whatever the hell she wants because of who her father is. Father's rich. We could add a really short movie. Well, we almost did have a short movie, but we could add a really short movie if she simply says, "Hey, Lottie, I've been wanting to buy this restaurant. Can I get a loan from your father? Or can your father Go ahead and do this, and I'll buy it, and I'll pay it back. Because when he comes to that restaurant, when he comes to Duke's restaurant that morning for his beignets, he's like, "Oh, I can't imagine anybody making these better than you, and you need to make these for." Or when Charlotte makes this comment about like, "Oh, well, you need to make all these for the masquerade party." Mind you, Tiana is her best friend. She wasn't invited to the masquerade party. Great, great moment that a lot of people overlook. She's not invited to the masquerade party. She's brought to the masquerade party to serve. So if they were, happen to be like great friends, really great friends, you would have this moment where she would have felt comfortable going to Lottie. Not that she would. Not that she would, because she never presented herself as looking for charity. But if they were really good friends, I could imagine at least Charlotte being aware enough to say, like, "Oh, damn, why are you working so hard? I want to start my own restaurant." "Well, I'll talk to Daddy and I'll get the money for you." Simple, right? But Charlotte is so consumed with what she wants. One could argue, not me, but one could argue that this is a criticism of white women in American society when you're talking about patriarchal issues, you're talking about white femininity, the white feminist movement, this whole idea of I need to get my shit, I need to get it now. You can wait. Because at this time, there is a rift within the new woman movement where there are new women. I'm sorry, there are women in the new women movement and the feminist movement in the 19 teens and 1920s that do not want black women to get the right to vote. They feel as though, because they've had their brand of feminism, that these black women should work for their rewards. They were also upset because white women were not allowed to vote before black men. And historically, you will see a good number of times. Now, I'm not saying anything bad about Charlotte or Lottie in the film, but she's a good representation of those issues if you look at it in that lens. But if, I gotta think about the best way to phrase this. You have a good number of historical examples in which white women, especially Southern white women, talk out of both sides of their face. I want equality for me. I want rights for me. I want to ensure that the country is better for me. So you see that in a lot of these movements because that first quarter of the 20th century, there were still suffragettes that were pissed that black men got the right to vote before they did. And when it was their turn, it was, "Nah, it's for us. Y'all got to get your own." So then it became a thing of where you did not have a substantial number of white feminists participating in the civil rights movement because, like Clarence Thomas, or to quote Clarence Thomas, "I got mine. Forget y'all." So even when the women's movement kicks off in the late 60s, there's a split there. The gay rights movement, there's a split there. All right, before I turn it over to all of you, King, I'm gonna give you guys some fun things to think about. Mama OD is probably Dr. Facilier's mother, and Juju's the father. Because there's way too much as far as the way that she deals with Juju. It indicates to you that Juju used to be human, and that a spell went wrong, and so she could never turn him back into being a human. Not only that, when they first come up, when they first say Juju's the snake. So when Mama Odie first shows up, when she first shows up, she blasts like all these little demons and whatever. And then she says, "Which one of y'all's been messing with the shadow man?" She would only know that if it was her son's magic. She wouldn't immediately like, "Oh, it's definitely Dr. Facilier. It's definitely him. I know it's him." You know, if she doesn't know who he is. So the fact that she knows who did the spell, she knows it's her son. Or at least somebody in her family. Thank you. No, Aisha, you're right. Because when he does has that moment where it's he's like, oh yeah, I'm royalty too on my mother's side, and holds up that shrunken head. But the idea that he's referring to Mama Obi, the voodoo queen of the bayou, there's nobody else. So my theory is going into this, Juju the snake is Mama Odie's husband who got turned in, he got turned into a snake, right? Dr. Facilier or Shadow Man is Mama Odie's son or grandson. And that's where we are. And plus she knew what needed to take place. So, all right, I don't know why I'm grabbing my mouse. I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to you guys. If you want to request to jump in. And then what I'm going to do is I will just serve as moderator for this. So if you want to participate, you want to talk. Yeah, she says, I'm 197 years old. It's possible he could have been her student, but I'm going with that's his mama. I mean, mainly because she knew way too much about she knew his magic as soon as she saw it. All right, we got one. All right, Lexi, come on in here.
I've got room for more. I said I was going to open up four, and I'm just going to be the moderator. So,
hi.
Hey, Lexi.
Hey. Sorry, I was playing with makeup before I saw your live, and I got so excited because I've wanted to talk about this movie for so long.
And you know what? That's the sad thing about it. Like a lot of movie, and this is one of the things I enjoyed about doing film discussions. Because it allows you to, because I think one of the homework things I gave was think about these aspects, think about these definitions when you're watching the film. The fact that I'm going to be my way, and then somebody else may see it based off of their lived experience, and then someone else will see different things in their lived experience. I've seen the movie many times. And I will tell you this, as soon as you get engaged with somebody else who saw it, you realize some other things have happened, have played into what they're seeing, and then it helps affect the way that you see it. So just because of the way that they may have filmed this and planned it out to be does not mean that that is the end all be all with the story. So I'm going to bring in Aisha and what is this? In focus, come on in. All right, I'm just going to sit back. Y'all can talk about the film, talk about what mattered to you, what stood out, what was important. Oh, and I won't let this thing fall.
So it's Ish. Briefly, can we talk about the similarities between Charlotte and Naveed? Whereas Charlotte is just this, you know, and that male-female dynamic where Charlotte is, you know, she's spoiled rotten. She gets whatever she wants. You know, mm-hmm. She's got her dad wrapped around her finger. Juxtapose Naveed, he's the man who comes from a wealthy family, and they're like, yo, bro, get your life together. And right. They both kind of live similarly in Sunshine, Rainbows, and Unicorn Farts, and the grounding rod is Tiana. But she can't, she's not saying certain things to Charlotte for that's my friend, I don't want to offend her. The things that I'm thinking she's saying to Naveed, she really wants to say to Charlotte too, because you just getting away with everything. When Charlotte said, all I have to do is wish a little harder, and mm-hmm. when they were at the masquerade ball, and Tiana's looking at her like, hussy, I stay here and made 500 yens for your ass, and you crying over a man that ain't even here. Like, and then you enter Naveen, and he's like, well, you know, I used to do whatever I want, and now my parents cut me off, and I don't know how to do anything. What was me? I'm like, I'm not a Disney girl. I told you I'm not a Disney girl. But that's what I saw with the two of them.
I'm telling you right now, I didn't think about that. And see, I was just talking about it when Lexi came on before the two of you were brought in. Again, I didn't even think about that, but that's something I need to go back and look at, because you're right. it is a good representation of how you have these two people that are living parallel lives, but one changes, right? So Naveen is wealthy. He's spoiled. Spoiled. Charlotte, because he even makes that comment of like, I've dated thousands. Oh, I dated a few women. So he's even talking about how cavalier he was with his sexual exploits, right? Because his title gives him access, his wealth gives him access. Charlotte's title and or her father's title is the sugar king or the daughter of the sugar baron. She gets access to so many things, including wealth, right? To where she's got men that have shown at the masquerade party to see her who want to get with her. Naveen doesn't want to get married. But he's been given that ultimatum by his family of like, you are going to do this or you got to go make your own way, buddy. If it had been flipped, Charlotte, this would have been like a very dark Disney movie if it had been flipped and Charlotte had to, you know, survive. Like she probably would have been out in the woods eaten by God knows how many animals because it wouldn't have worked out for her. But no, that was something I didn't think about. In focus, what about you?
So that makes a lot of sense. I didn't think about it before, but it does make a lot of sense, especially when you look at like how within society, you know, when you look at who's closest to power, it does fall in line. So it because of their proximity to the top, they would enjoy living a more delusional life because they're not forced to have to work twice as hard like Tiana. So I definitely get that part. What I was actually going to bring up, because on my channel, I do film analysis for Black films. And actually, I'm getting ready to do one for Princess and the Frog, but particularly focusing on food as legacy. And what I thought was interesting about this film is how Tiana goes about creating a dream, like creating her father's dream, and how the biggest lesson for her is that it's not about necessarily making exactly what he wanted happening, but to actually allow herself to include herself in her own dream and branch it out. And then also in terms of society and power, if you look at New Orleans, I mean, New Orleans is known for its food. Mm-hmm. Like it's a culinary hub spot, but her being denied the ability to actually own a restaurant talk like also points to how there's a control in who is allowed to profit off of the legacy of that culinary power. Because food, I mean, you know, restaurants make money. Mm-hmm. So by that defect, they're controlling who has access to profit off of the culinary legacy of that place.
When I watch, I get and I want to eat.
Yeah. I mean, she's known for her beignets. And even when she is in the diner, that's her business that she's making money off of. That's not something on the menu that the head chef makes. That's her beignets that she's actually getting paid for. So she's actually already starting her own business for what she's known for, but she's not allowed to fully profit off of it, as with the history of Black people who have created soul food. Our ability to profit off of it has been largely limited and regulated, which is why, you know, it's more common to see somebody do a fish fry on Sunday and sell plates mm-hmm. than it is to see them have their own business.
Right. Yeah. You mentioned something, and I'm sorry, like, I'm going to come right back to you. You mentioned both of you mentioned something that made me think about this that I didn't get into. Charlotte, if she had married the fake Naveen, right? If she had married him, the plan that Dr. Facilier had was, I'm going to kill the sugar baron. I'm going to kill Big Daddy. Because the law at this time, because of the way it regards gender and deals with gender, Lottie would not have inherited that property. It would have gone to her husband. And that's why he was making that bargain with the demon, saying like, hey, I'm going to get rid of him and I'll be in charge. And then what we'll do is we'll run this place, because he would be able to run the fake Naveen, but Naveen, the fake Naveen, would end up inheriting everything. Lottie would have no say because of the way the laws were written, especially the Louisiana laws and some of the old Napoleonic code. Your husband gets the...
Yeah, he's entitled to what she inherits.
Mm-hmm. Every last cent. And then you throw in, I think it wasn't until the 1970s that women couldn't get bank accounts or credit cards in their own name. They had
1974.
Their father or their husband approve it in order for them to get there. Think about how far, how far collectively we've come, and step backwards as well. Sorry, Lexi, I thought you had something.
No, I was just going to agree with the depictions of privilege that they have between, I think, Charlotte and Naveen. Just one of those moments where you see like Disney's depiction of privilege is actively like being able to be lazy, like being able to kind of have leisure. It's a way to like depict that someone has like a status or a higher up that you like, that you can't necessarily just create for yourself in the way that Tiana's working so hard to try and make it. I think you see that again in like Aladdin, Jasmine's father. He's the king, and all he does throughout the movie is basically just eat and lounge around and then look for husbands for Jasmine. But he gets to do whatever he wants. He doesn't have anything he has to do. And so Naveen and I think Charlotte have that same privilege. And it's a reoccurring, I feel like, theme and character format that they have for people of extreme wealth throughout Disney.
Yeah. Ashley brought up something. I didn't get into this. I did as far as like DMs and stuff. But with respect to Naveen, he's made racially ambiguous for a reason. One, it's to not upset too many people, because it's the way that we treat race, especially mixed race marriages. If it's non-white, non-white, it's not looked at. If it's partner, non-white partner, then there's a little bit more of an issue, a controversy, some discomfort. But what did the two of you think about having Naveen from a nondescript country, but he's royalty? I mean, in all honesty, it's somebody who lived in that part of the country and has family who's still there, who still lives there. Naveen would have fit in more in New Orleans than Big Daddy and Charlotte would have.
Yeah.
Why do either of you think, or any of you, because there are three of you, think about the way in which the role of race and gender play with respect to the relationship between Naveen and Tiana, despite from, hey, we're just going to make them both frogs so nobody thinks about race for about 40, 50 minutes.
It literally made me think, why couldn't this whole movie be placed in a kingdom? If we're gonna just create a fake kingdom and kind of like move around race and be a little bit more flexible, why couldn't this movie have been placed in a completely black society? And I know that that sounds like a little bit rough, but I feel like the only other Disney princess movie that does this is Pocahontas, and it does really centralize whiteness in a way.
Okay.
And I feel like with Tiana, Princess and the Frog, you have this, I don't know. I feel like when I first watched the movie, I was a lot younger. And like my idea of what a Disney princess, a black Disney princess would be so impacted by this idea that it would be a princess that kind of gets to be outside of the problems that I was dealing with in my everyday life. And so to place her in America, you already are going to have those racial issues. There's an undercurrent of it the entire movie, which is real life, but like there are points in history and in time where we had were completely black, we still live today. And so the idea that like the movie had to be a black American princess, as a black American, I like it, but it also like brings up these race issues that we could have kind of like sidestepped and just dealt with black issues and black, like, I don't know, connections with each other. instead of it being also fighting a society. That was like my only, I know it's a little bit off from what the question was, but because he was perfect. From a different land, I was like, why can't we just make a land? And then they did for Black Panther, but like, it was just one of those things I looked at and I was like, I kind of wanted something where she doesn't have to deal with those things.
Because before this, I don't want to cut you off, Aisha, but because before this, some of you may be old enough to remember the Cinderella with Whitney Houston and Brandy. I know I'm old enough.
Yeah.
And I remember at the time, it was a big deal. I mean, of course, social media wasn't a thing then. But it was a big deal because you had an Asian Prince Charming. You had a Black Cinderella. You had a white king, you had a Black queen, and then you just had everybody. It was just everybody's mix. The stepsisters were Black and white. So you got to see, I don't want to say a race neutral depiction of Cinderella, but you got to have a presentation of the film of Cinderella where you're going to have bunches of different kids who may be watching as well as adults that are now going to be able to see themselves this way. Same thing with Little Mermaid. Same thing with, what was the other one that came out? I can't think of it now. But as far as like having those representations are very important, because what a lot of people don't realize when they say something like, why does the mermaid have to be Black? She didn't have to be white. She didn't have to be. Europa is the goddess of the sea, and she's Black. But it depends on who's telling the story and who wants to be represented, things like that. But in all, she didn't have to be white. She could have been Asian. She could have been any number of things. But by having somebody of that background, whatever the background is, you have representation for a group that may not have been represented before or is not fully included or even known about in a lot of cases. Because often with not necessarily this film, well, I would say with this film as well. With films like this, it may introduce people to cultures that they're not familiar with. You might be familiar with the stereotype of the generalization of New Orleans or Louisiana itself, but you may not be familiar with those little nuances. Like somebody asked on here about Ray, and one of the things I would say about Ray is representing folks from Acadiana, and outside of Acadiana, people don't know much about that culture. They don't know that much about the way that people talk there. When the movie Waterboy came out, of all movies, when Waterboy came out, I was translating Cajun Joe, I think was the character they came up with. I was translating for my friends. They're like, what the hell did he say? He said, you win some, you lose some. They're like, how the hell did you know? I said, I have family who talks like this. I know this. So when this movie came out, you had Ray, talking with his dialect, and then you had the Kunasses, because that's who those guys were on the boats who were trying to get the frogs. They're Kunasses. That's the group of people that they're referred to as or known as. And they don't get along that well with Cajuns. So it was great for them to throw that in, but the fact that they included that when they didn't have to cultures that they weren't familiar with. A lot of people just looked at the film and probably thought, oh, these are hillbillies or rednecks, right? But by having the Kunasses in there as humans, and then having the Cajuns and Acadiana people as the fireflies, the firebugs, lightning bugs, it allows you to see them, no pun intended, in a different light. I had to stop myself. I'm like, oh no, I'm not doing this intentionally.
No dad jokes. what I was going to say is with regard to the racial and ambiguous nature of Naveen, that could be Disney's way of sidestepping left-handed marriages and the children that came out of that. Because if you know about left-handed marriages and you know, multi-ethnic children, then mm-hmm. it's just kind of their way of saying, yeah, you know, this is these are a grouping of people here in Louisiana, but we're really not going to discuss that because you still have people even now that are showing their true colors about like interracial marriage or multi-ethnic people and so on and so forth. So even back then, that's kind of their way of saying, yeah, no, that with a wink and a nudge kind of, like, if that makes sense.
Oh, no, I got it.
100%. I also feel like it helped them sidestep the issue of a very stereotypical depiction of a Black man being lazy. So Naveen is like super not concerned. He's not motivated at the beginning of the movie. He's had a life of leisure, and that could come across really bad if they had made him just straight up a Black prince, because I think that we would have a little bit more issue with the fact that like the Black princess is super hardworking and then the Black prince is not.
But we do kind of get the view of crab syndrome when Tiana's at Duke's and she's talking to the fry cook and he's like, you'll never have your own restaurant. And he goes to this whole thing with her and she's just like, all right, whatever. We have that within the culture of this is where I am. So where I am should be good enough for you. How it's almost like, how dare you have a bigger dream than this? And it's like, okay, yes, that does happen, but Disney, do you have to make it? That could have come from anyone. You had to make it the Black fry cook in Duke's, which is supposed to be Dookie Chase's, but you know, you had to put that in there, like that thing of, yes, well, we're not going to make Black men lazy, but we're going to make this Black man cut Tiana short.
Right.
You know, now, so that was
the four of you here. I'm going to ask the four of you this question, and I'm asking this question genuinely. How do you feel? And I'm not sure if everybody is expressing this identity, but everybody on here, as far as the box is Black women. Yes, no?
Yep.
Yeah.
My question is, because I just want to make sure, I don't want to have any Rachel Dolezal moments where somebody pretends and shows up, because I had one of those before and we got into a conversation. Because, well, one, I don't want anybody speaking on something that they are not. I'm never going to speak for Black women. So I'm asking this question. How did this feel, or how represent Black womanhood, Black femininity, Black identity, in specific examples that you may or may not have?
I hate it. Lady, can I please go? Please. I think I'm an unpopular opinion, but I absolutely hated this film as representation of Black women. Hated this film from start to finish for a couple of reasons. I hated that she was a hardworking, independent Black woman trope, and that she had to get to her dream by marrying this racially ambiguous, lazy guy that honestly did not deserve her in the entire film. I felt like he was using her for labor, for his survival, for his basic survivals of cutting up stuff in the woods to the survival of even getting to Mama Odie. I absolutely hated this damn film. I think that it did a disservice for the culture of New Orleans on a bigger grand scale when we talk about voodoo, hoodoo, Santeria.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
There was a very misstep in the way that it was written. I did not like the shadow man. I felt like it kind of played into those tropes as well. The Black woman has to save the day, sacrifice herself. The Black dad is dead in the home, and she's gotta, you know, work all these hours for this white person. I absolutely hated this representation. I thought that Black Panther did way better in giving us representation, but it was not from an African-American standpoint of Black women. It was from our, you know, our Black sisters that are, you know, across the seas, right? And so, of course, we got this curious representation, but even Killmonger was from America and he didn't quite have the morality set pinpoint that we needed. And came from their resources and all these different things. And I just felt like it missed the mark with where our magic comes from and the background of it. And it just, it could have been so much better written. And I was born in 89, so I'm a little bit older. So when this movie came out, I was just not impressed. This was not a me watching this as a child type of thing. So right. I'll let my other sisters get in, but I absolutely hated this film. Absolutely hated.
I was with you on that. How I felt.
Karma, if anybody ever confronts you about that, you got the right positioning. Because I've run into people like, I'm sorry, I didn't like. No, you didn't like it. You didn't like it. You didn't like the way things were done. You didn't like it. And that's what this discussion is about. It's about getting into what worked, the lens that we're looking at, the perspective that's presented. The way that things hit for us, the way that things missed. So I'm applauding you. So, I mean, I would, but then it would be just weird for me to sit up. Actually, I think I can send you. There we go. So, Lexi.
I agree. So I have a hard time just coming out and saying, like, I hated this movie, because a part of me feels like that's anti-Black, because it's our first Black princess, right? And so I don't want to just say, like, ugh, I hated it. But I did, because I just feel like, as Black women, our depictions are so stereotypical sometimes. Like, we're either really hardworking, or we're Jezebels, or we're all of these things. And like, I wanted for this movie to be a Black woman who maybe was a little bit fragile. Someone that you could view through a lens of, she's worth saving. She doesn't have to save herself, because other people see her value and want to be a part of helping out. Because I think our reality in a lot of cases is we have to work super hard, not because we love working, but because no one's gonna save us. And so if we live in a reality where we're having to work twice as hard, that's a true depiction. But when I'm looking at a princess, what I want my Black princess to experience, I want her to have the space to be strong and be fragile, to be delicate, to be something that where the prince turns around and looks and says, she's working too hard, let me pick it up. Let me do more, because I want her to be safe and I want her to be good. And that's like something that I really wish I could have seen. I also have a little bit of an issue with it, and I've said this a little bit already, with it being set in America. We didn't have to for the first Black princess. And I think that I would have liked a magical land where we were just dealing with normal human issues, because we are normal humans as Black people, and we aren't also dealing with racism. Right. And I know that that is something that, like, it is very magical thinking, but that's what Disney does. It does magical thinking for the most part for almost every other race other than Native American people. And like, which what I've seen, like, they don't necessarily do people of color well, but for all their white princesses, all they're dealing with is like normal everyday stuff. But it, like, that's how I was hoping we would get a depiction. Not that I want to emulate whiteness, but I just feel like in a lot of cases, like my relationship issues or whatever, it's between me and that person. And I'm not like thinking about like race in the mix of it. But I feel like with Tiana and Naveen, that you have to, because he's not Black, and you do have to like think about like their difference in experience and why their relationship is doing the things that they're doing throughout the movie. But I'm just throwing that out there.
I'm just gonna kind of like piggyback. In the very beginning, Disney's target audience was white people. Let's be real, Hollywood's target audience is white people always. So when you have like Good Times or Princess and the Frog or whatever, Hollywood is going to show us all as monochrome. Mm. Hollywood has not understood that we are all very different from socioeconomic backgrounds, lifestyles, the way we talk, the way we hang out, the music we listen to.
Right.
It's easier for Hollywood, Disney, to categorize Black women as one thing, because then you have to do the research. You have to get to know people who are outside of your box of thinking. You have to say, hey, look, maybe for Tiana, maybe we need to have a group of Black women from variation to put their ideas in. Like, when you don't have that, and I'm not saying that the person that you know, created Tiana or whatever, wasn't black, but
they weren't.
It's they weren't. But it's easier to say, well, all black women are like this, versus, well, no, Isha loves comic books and this and this and this, and you know, and Lexi loves literature and she does this and she, you know, it's easier to categorize us in one way and build a story off of the tropes. Are black women, and I'm gonna say it and y'all not gonna like it, but it is what it is. Are we the workhorses of society? Yes, we are. But that does not negate that we're girls, that we like being pretty, we like getting our hair done, we cry sometimes, but Hollywood, particularly Disney, will never give an audience that, because then that takes nuance. That takes, well, maybe I need to understand this different part of my audience. Mm. Little black girls go to Disney World and Disneyland. Yeah. How fucked up is it, sorry y'all, that you only see one black princess? Like, come on. Like,
it's actually deeper than just nuance. In order to have those stories, it would actually mean that they would have to let go of some power and creative control in order to allow those people to come in and give those authentic stories. And that's something that they're not wanting to do. They don't even care anymore about white audiences, okay? Disney's so like in the bag, they know they can just blink twice and just say, like, they could put their name on poop on the floor and 16 kids are gonna line up to watch it in IMAX, okay?
Right.
Like, they don't have to do that. So the audience is never a problem for them. Yeah. At this point, it is just the fact that they continually recycle the same cis, hetero, white men to create these stories, and all they do is send them out into the world to go find the people of color and be like, tell me about your land and your ways. And then they come back and they say, all right, I learned all these things, but how can I make it so that it looks like I'm the creative genius behind this?
Okay.
The white savior.
And then I would add, I was writing down because I did not want to interrupt and I didn't want to forget, but you all hit this, and it's basically, these movies are made by people who are uncomfortable with non-white people who want to make a movie for white Disney audiences to be comfortable with non-white people.
Yes.
And as a way, like, hey, here's something that you need to think about. And that's why I say, like, the thing about Louis being an allegory or metaphor about Jim Crow, it works and it doesn't work, because you're still not going to be treated equally. You're going to try to get that with your own community. But there have been too many times, but there have been too many times that cultural blindness or ethnic blindness has been with these films. What was that movie? Straight Outta Compton a few years ago. Great movie. But there weren't any black voices in the writing room other than, you know, the members of NWA who were part of the group, what the film was about. But the writers of the film were white. Not taking away anything from them. Can't say that they can't make the movie, anything like that. But
no, they can't make the movie. It's okay, you can say it.
And they didn't even hire black casting directors either. So the way that they depicted, like, unattractive women, they said dark-skinned something women to depict.
Yeah, they were at the bottom of the list.
It was so ridiculous. I remember.
I think we don't give Disney enough credit. I think they did exactly what they meant to do. I think sometimes we think that they have some cultural blindness or they don't have sensitivity, but I personally think they are doing exactly what's on program and scheduling, which is, let me pander to the black audience by giving them a black princess, by also capitalizing on people of color by making it Naveen, which is racially ambiguous. And then let me also make sure that we have white people that are also in the film who are still in a privileged state so that we can make sure that we collectively get it. I think that it is very strategic, and I think that sometimes we think they don't know, but I think that their course of action is just, it's very planned. Even in the movie, we see that the jester for Naveen, which is a very interesting character that people don't talk about, but he wanted the magic to become Naveen. He didn't want it to become the white, you know, dad or anything else. He wanted to be Naveen, which is already enough right there of how many white people do we see that want to be racially ambiguous, but not necessarily black experience, right? And so even in that, I think that was programming in itself, right, to try and make sure that they're capturing and they look at our TikToks and Twitter and all these different things. And I think that they strategically give us a program that is digestible and palatable for every type of audience. And I think it is very, very strategic. I don't think that they're just like completely blind to the facts of not doing it. I think they do enough by making sure Neo is on the soundtrack. Right? And they do just enough because they know that black people love music, right? We have cultural wars and understanding about whether or not we should cancel black artists for different things. They know that we're attracted to the music, and we know that, you know, hip hop is leading in one of the top listening, right? And so they know to put Neo on the soundtrack, but they also know different things. It is a very strategic marketing plan, and they know exactly what they're doing and how to get there. You know, you have to know your audience very well. And I think that sometimes we think they're dumber than they actually are. I think they know their audience extremely well.
Now, when you say cultural blind, what I mean as far as like not getting into the depth, as far as like not knowing what to talk about. Because there were a couple of people in the comments that were confused about the way I was approaching it. The idea that you have someone who's going to write about it, but they're going to write about it from a comfortable position. Whereas one of the best quotes that I ever heard about making a movie came from Denzel Washington. So when he was making, I believe it was Fences, he was interviewed and they asked him, why did you insist? Because I think he was producing the film as well as he had a couple of roles other than acting. But they asked him, like, why did you specifically seek out a black director for this film? And he responded and said, I need someone who knows black culture. Mm. And the person, I think, that responded, I said, oh, you know, you're saying somebody doesn't know. I said, that's not what I'm saying. I need someone who knows what it smells like in a black person's house on Sunday morning.
Mm-hmm.
And the interviewer was white, and I think it was CBS or what, and she kind of looked at him with, you know, deer stuck in the headlights. And he was like, I need someone who knows what a hot comb with oil pressing up against a hair or scalp, what it smells like.
Yeah.
Because if you don't know what that smells like, you don't know the movie I'm trying to make. And I think that's a fault that a lot of people have outside looking in when they're making these films, is they're not making that authentic experience either purposely or accidentally. So when I talk about that blindness, it can be intentional. It could just be like, I just want to make a movie about, I'll pick on NW. I'll make a movie about NWA, but I'll leave out a bunch of stuff that, you know, people aren't going to be comfortable watching in the film, but they need to watch it. They need to learn these things. They need to actually not see that everything was sunshine and rainbows, you know, with certain aspects of their careers, and definitely not show that everybody was a hero. But
I think it's definitely intentional. I think it's definitely intentional because if the people who are servicing the dollars is still operating in white supremacy, then there's still a white supremacy agenda, right? And they never lose focus of how they can program. And as we all know, black people can be complicit in white supremacy as well. So even when they're making these movies, they understand how the black dollar works. However, we want to make sure that it's still under the guise of white supremacy. So let me make sure I make a movie of a black princess, but I'm going to keep her green and a frog the entire movie. And I'm going to leave out certain histories about New Orleans, about their magic. And I'm going to make sure they still understand that still from their other counterparts without them actually knowing that. Because even though I know Lexi has stated like earlier that she would have loved it to be in a magical kingdom like Snow White, we also have to realize that white culture doesn't have a culture. So they have to make it up. But we have a culture, right? And we have history that it would have been way more empowering that we would have taken what our ancestors brought over and really capitalized on that and making Black people feel magical leaving out of that movie theater. And so, of course, Snow White and them have to be in a magical land. Where else would they be? What else would they be doing? They have no culture.
Yo,
Karma, I'm dying.
Karma got all the smoke for him, yo. All the smoke.
During the Middle Ages.
I do want to be honest. I have worked for Disney last year. And so I will say that some of the pushback that they are receiving is coming internally. So if you want to keep Black talent, you have to bend a little bit as an organization and care about Black issues, or you're going to lose that Black talent to people who are real competitors to you now, like Netflix, like Hulu. Hulu, they bought out because they could. But like those things are real pressures for them to create content that their employees want to make as well. I would also say that a lot of the times though, even when people want to make these movies that are culturally significant and things like that, they will not green light it the way it's written. And so you'll have this watering down of culture that happens with each edit because it has to go through like 6 rounds of approval. Mm-hmm. I will also say that the new Bob that just took over from the old Bob is very old school Disney, and that's who released the first Tiana movie. And the Bob CEO that was trying to create a panel of people of different cultural backgrounds just got ousted by all of the So it's a real thing. Like Disney is, there are people who were fighting for diversity in representation that are slowly being removed in the highest levels. So just like, it is not fake. You're not imagining it. It's definitely happening. And with the success of Black Panther, they had hired a lot more Black creative directors and producers, and those people are slowly leaving.
But see, the thing is, they hired them for the wrong reasons. Like, the reason that Black Panther was received so well is because the intentionality was in it to create exactly what he's been talking about, which is the authentic experience, something that we can gravitate towards. Disney didn't hire them to create authenticity. Disney hired them to say, make me money like Black Panther. It's like, it wasn't going to work anyway, because all that would have happened is the people would have been like, hey, this is how you do it. And they would have been like, that's trash. I need you to change that. And then after they change it, they'd be like, why wasn't this successful? I hired you. Like, that's all that's happening. And that's all that continues to happen, because you have to first actually buy into the idea that the story has value. And that's something that they can't do, because that would mean that Black people have value. And my God, if you thought that, Jesus, the world would apparently crumble for them.
Yeah, it definitely would.
I'm going to let Aisha go, then I'm going to have to end. But the point that you made about the idea of valuing those stories, again, that goes to this idea when I talked about the lens, omission, your perspectives, invention, things like that, those things I talked about earlier. The idea that if you show that there's value to these stories, you admit that these individuals, these groups, these cultures have value as well. Some people are not going to accept that. Some people are going to look at it as, which I've heard way too many times when I got in these discussions, like, well, why'd you make this person Black? Why'd you make this person, you know, Latina? Why'd you do this? Why don't you make your own? I'm like, this wasn't even your own. Cinderella has been a story that's been recycled so many times. Who gives a damn if she, I don't give a damn if she's Asian right now. Like, in fact, I want that live action. I want an Indonesian Cinderella. I want to see it, because there are Indonesian folks that need to be represented. There are indigenous folks that need to be represented. And one of the good, I wouldn't say best, but one of the really good representations I saw this past year was a movie I did not think was going to get good representation, and that was the film Prey, the Predator prequel, where they had Comanche folks, and they used Comanche language, they used Comanche folks in the film, and they made sure, the production company made sure that they were as respectful to their culture as possible, as far as representing the history that was there in the thing they portrayed him in the 18th century, but then also making a sci-fi horror movie at the same time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I'm sorry, Isha, go ahead. And
no, it's kind of like a question. So we all collectively agree that unless we want these stories to be made, there has to be value to all parties involved. Mm-hmm. How do we do that now? We all know the problem. We all know what it is. People bitching and moaning because Little Mermaid was black, where they're clinging to the idea that in these fantasy worlds, black people don't exist.
Mm-hmm. Well, that is a lot of white people's fantasy.
It's a white people's fantasy, right. We know this concretely. How do we change it? We know we can't go to mainstream. Mm-hmm. They're looking at the bottom dollar, and I have to make this palatable to everybody, so it's asses and seeds. Excuse me, I'm sorry, B. No. But how do we now collectively make this change? We all know what the problems are. How do we make this collective change?
Here's what I would say about it. It comes down to supporting your writers of color first. So there's Children of Blood and Bone that came out a few years ago. It's like a whole series.
Yes, amazing book.
There's Afrofuturism, there's Black Fantasy. And I'm just going to, because we're talking about Princess Frog, we're talking about Black issues. The Hate U Give, like with Angie Thomas's right. book went from being a book to a movie in less than 2 years. I have issues with the movie. The book is fantastic. They color swapped the lead character, and I was upset because she went from being a dark-skinned black woman, black girl, she was a teenager, to being nothing against...
Amandla.
Yeah, Amandla Seyfried, nothing against her, but she was chosen because a light-skinned black girl is less threatening in a film of that structure than if she had been dark-skinned, because of the way it typically gets discussed, represented, and pushed. Mm-hmm. But any of these books that you see that are written by black authors, and Aisha, no, I'm not, I haven't started on the next book, so don't bother me about
you
it.
You play too much.
So supporting authors of color, because we need more black stories, indigenous stories, Latina stories. We need more African continent stories that are not somebody's fantasy version of what Africa is like, but actually what Africans are writing about. Same thing with folks in Latin America, as far as, because we've been getting a lot of white stories out of Latin America, but we need more people of color. In fact, this will not be the assignment for next week. There is a Brazilian movie called Bacurau, B-A-K-A-R-A-O-U, Bacurau, something. It is a film that is basically an Afrofuturism film in Brazil. So it's a multiracial town that is supposed to be like 20, 30 years in the future. And you're seeing how this community has kind of created, I don't want to give anything away. I'm just going to say watch the movie because it's fantastic. But getting more of those stories, the thing is, it's going to be like A24, independent houses and stuff like that are going to be able to bring these out, because when Disney makes a movie like this, they're already throwing $100 million at it. So you better come back $500 million, $600 million. But when you got a small movie company a small budget film company like A24, they make it a habit. They don't spend more than $10 million on a movie.
Yes.
And the same thing with Blumhouse. A24 and Blumhouse do not spend a lot of money on movies, and they end up getting great product out of it. That's how we got Get Out. Get Out was from Blumhouse. I think, $10, $15 million on it.
I would like to add to your thought that I think we have a plethora of black stories. Plethora. Yeah. Like, you named some amazing books, right? And I wanted to answer Nova's question by saying that I do not think it's necessarily about needing the content. It is how can they market the content to the general masses? Because Blood and Bone and some other books you made, like, unless you're on black book TikTok, you probably, right. The comment section may have never heard of that. Not that they don't want to support it, but they have never heard, because we know that our marketing on TikTok and other platforms we use are also generated through dollars of white supremacy. So if we don't want these movies and our content whitewashed, it's about what platforms can they put it on and how can they market, because our dollars run the economy at this point. We can push and make anything popular. I think the question is, how do we make sure that people aren't shadow banned, they're not blocked? Like, how do we get it out to the rest of our community? Because when our community shows up, it shows up and it shows out. And I think that's where we kind of lose, like, the perspective of supporting some of our black films. Is 9 out of 10 people have no idea it was on Peacock, or they didn't know it was on Tubi, or they never heard of it until some famous TikToker or popular person said, hey, you guys need to go watch this. And then that's when we jump on it. So I think it's about the marketing and the platform that we choose to tell our stories is the most monumental part of making sure that we're represented in the right way. Because as we were talking about Black Panther, unpopular opinion, I do not think Black Panther would have even made it past Disney if the story was not set on the continent of Africa. If it wasn't an American story of us having some secret vibranium and fucking people up, we would not have that story. So it is very strategic, even when we look at Black Panther and this random white guy who was in the story, who was like our ally and our savior that helps us throughout, was still very strategic, right? That Ryan Coogler had to write in order for those dollars to be pushed and that script to be approved. So I think it's just about finding ways for our stories to be told on platforms that won't be destroyed, right? Because it's not like Black people haven't had a history of building things and they be destroyed. My question, how do we build things without it being destroyed? Right? Because we've seen Tulsa, Rosewood, and all these other things. How do we build a platform? How do we build an app? How do we build these things without it coming towards white supremacy and it being wiped out? And then our voices doesn't be heard. I think if we figure that answer out, we will get to see the stories that people are writing every day that we don't really get to know about.
I want to chime in because I love how whenever we have great conversations that we start to get to a place of solutions. But I think one of the pitfalls as a community is that when we come up with, when we start getting to the solutions portion, we kind of treat it like it doesn't exist when that's not the case. There are a lot of platforms that solely focus on Black stories. And what I'd like to say is, if you really want to support stories, start going to Black film festivals.
That's what I was about to say.
There's Black Star Fest. There's, I'm a part of the Luminal Theater. I actually do work for a small nomadic film company that focuses on Black films and African films. And I do monthly videos for them. My platform itself is solely dedicated to just analyzing Black film. Okay. We have tons of festivals that are out there, but the willingness to just type in Black Film Festival near me, or even finding when they're located and making an effort to put that out there, the stories are being made. And actually what's happening is, because a lot of the stories that are being made are short format, they're coming out of the pockets of the creators themselves. So they're either doing grants or they're fundraising or crowdfunding for their movies. And not get a good return, because there's, to put it online, they risk it being basically stolen and scalped.
Yes.
Right.
So they have to go the route, they try to go the route of film festivals to protect security and an investment of their film. So for the community itself, it's making its way out there to go see those short films, because once those short films start getting the audience, that's when A24 and Blumhouse will go and say, hey, we're going to green light that short for a feature, because a lot of these filmmakers are making their shorts as just basically the prequel to the feature.
And you can find tons of those people on TikTok, on social media. I would encourage people to start looking at film festivals and seeing the films that are there and starting to follow those people on Instagram and social media. When they have crowdfunding for their next films, donate $1, donate $2, yes. Post it on your social media and say, hey, we got a Black filmmaker who's making this film. Can you give $1 or $2, $3, $4, $5, whatever you can do. And not only are we promoting those films, but we're empowering them and we're empowering the creators. Because I'll tell you, Issa Rae was the great prime example of what it means to build your audience, yeah, so that you can show up to any table and walk away from any table.
100%. The only other thing I would add with you is look at the studios right now that have already come to terms with the SAG-AFTRA demands.
Right.
A lot of those studios are owned and they're small by people who are not just rich old white men, and not in a bad, not to like hate on the rich old white men, but like, if you want studios that are producing and focusing on Black stories, women's stories, the studios that have already agreed to the terms are those studios. And I'm hoping that this big push from actors and writers will get the studio a little bit more. Hopefully more contracts with these bigger platforms. I know that that's hopeful looks, but if you are watching and you're willing to put some money towards their features, it gives them a better chance of giving that big global audience that everyone wants if we want to get these kinds of stories out there.
I would also add, Lexi, that some of our Black film creators that are like in his comment section, I believe that Tubi, you can like put your movie out right now. And so all of us are watching Tubi movies. Like we're laughing at them if they're like under budget. But remember that Black culture, we follow whatever. So like, even if you put a movie on Tubi, if it's a good movie and Black people are watching it, please don't hesitate to submit your movie to Tubi. I don't know what their contract conditions are. So I would never, you know, promote Tubi if they're like selling the rights, you know, to your movie and can do whatever and then change it. But sometimes we have to find ways to put them on platforms because we are the culture and we make things popular. And Tubi is popular right now because of Black people, because we're talking about it on Twitter. And I wish that Black people understood the power of popularity, that we make things and we can put out whatever as long as we tell each other that it's out there and we'll support it. We will 100% support it if it's good.
Yeah, there's an all Black platform too. There's an all Black platform that's specifically dedicated to all Black film. Onyx is a new subset of Hulu that Kerry Washington is working with. So, I mean, they're pushing out a lot of Black-centered content. Now, they're a little bit higher up, but it's out there. And honest to God is literally just following the people who are willing to talk about it. And there are people.
And I think All Black is like an additional like $3.99 with your Prime, because it comes with Prime. Yeah. And so I have All Black and I watch every single Black film that comes across to see if it's good or not. Now, just because you're Black, let's be clear. If it's not good, we're going to tell you because we're a Black culture, right? And when we strive for Black excellence, and that can be, and Black excellence can be discussed on a different type of live, but we like good content. And All Black, I definitely watch. It's extra $3.99. It comes with Prime. It's right there. And I definitely watch those. So even if you put your content for some of the film creators that's on this live there, we will find it and we will promote it if it's good, because that's all you need is us to support you. If you haven't seen, like, and that's just historical, right? We support Kanye West and then they go mainstream, right? We support Nicki Minaj and then they go mainstream, but we make them pop first and then they cross over. So don't underestimate, which I wish this film did, is really tap into how we influence stuff. This movie, Princess and the Frog, could have been so good if they would have chose a different type of narrative to be able to input a Black princess on here, because our popularity, our culture, our swag, how we influence people, this could have been a phenomenal movie that represented us. And even having Naveen be Daquan instead would have influenced our Black boys to know that they too could have been princes. And it would have been amazing if we could have seen some Black male representation of what that looked like, but they killed the dad off, right? And so seeing what Black men should have looked like in a film and what that leading role would have looked like and protection would have looked like for her and those navigating of the woods and all those different things, it could large-scale conversation, right, where we wouldn't be up here arguing with each other within our community about, you know, submission and all these different things. If it would have been put right on the screen, then we could have seen a Black male lead her through the woods, and I guarantee you my Black sisters would have been like, yes honey, I'm trying to let down my cape, let Daquan, Prince Daquan, mix these damn onions, right? Yeah. But instead, we got her who has fallen in love with a guy that can't mince onions in a woods. Like, what? So it missed the mark. He couldn't even do laundry. I am so mad at Tiana for talking to him, because sis, you deserve more. And yeah. I tell her that every time we visit Disney, because there's such amazing characters down there. But I say you could have did better, right? Because real Black men, they do all of those things. And I would have even loved to see a Black male prince really do those things in America, not Black Panther that is showing me Prince T'Challa, and he's not from here. I would have loved to see that we protect each other. This could have been a very nuanced film, and it could have really brought us together as a culture, and it missed the mark on so many goddamn levels that it was just a pandering to our Black audience, and it was a pandering and a systematic programming for our younger babies. And they missed the mark on that. And I'm very disappointed.
All right, with that, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to thank everybody for being on the live. I definitely want to thank all of you, Lexi, Aisha. I've got Karma in the info. I can't remember if you said your name or not.
Oh, my name's Brian.
Right. Hey, thank Brian. You so much. I want to thank all of you for being this, because as I've you know, communicated with Aisha a good number of times, every now and then you have these moments where I'm not ready to go back and talk about this. This has rejuvenated me, and this is why I wanted to have these discussions, is because even if it's a film that it's been 14 years, this movie's been out. Even if it's a film that's been 14 years, 30, 40, 50, whatever, however many times you've seen it, you get a new perspective when you have conversations with other folks about those films. So I want to thank all of you. I don't have a movie.
They Clone Tyrone. I am saying, please do They Clone Tyrone. I would love to hear your perspective on it.
I really, really want to talk about it too. I'll come back for that.
All right. We will do that eventually. Because I had some people the first time I did this that were arguing, because I put up my syllabus of the film that I had for Film is History. So I'll put together a video, and just in the comment section, people could decide what to, and I'll include, you know, We Clone Tyrone in it as well. And somebody on here also mentioned The Blackening. I'm all in on that one. So I'll put some films that were on the syllabus and some that weren't, as far as some recent films. And we'll set that up, and we'll just do it at the same time next week.
We're pulling you out of retirement. You're about to be a professor again. We're pulling you out of retirement, and we're adding new films of present day on your syllabus to get ready.
Hey,
Lovecraft Country is a great one as well in your comment section at that.
Well, Lovecraft Country was a series, so I mean that's how many episodes was it? Like 13 or something?
That could be the final.
Look, that show made me angry for so many reasons. One, because they didn't have a season two. But I had to stay home. I was like, I'm not leaving the house, because I'm already crying. I'm upset. I'm watching Journey Smollett like walk down the street as everything's set on fire, and how the dad can't save his friend. Like I was inconsolable. I couldn't go anywhere.
Yeah, we're pulling you out of retirement. I just want you to know that. Like, we're adding stuff in your comment section because there was another, and I can't think of the show. Somebody help me in the comments that I really think you should do, but it was on Prime. It was a Prime original, y'all. It had one season, and the one episode I remember is Cat in the Bag. I hope somebody.
Oh, us. I'm sorry.
But, I can't remember if it was us or them. I knew it was
them. Put that on there, and that is a disclaimer that it's a lot. It's a lot, and you got to pace yourself watching that. But oh my God, was that a psychological thing? And I think you should do that one too. And that's just my tidbit with that.
I'm gonna put 5 options. I'll make a video. I'll put the 5 options. People can comment. I think I followed everybody on here. Please follow these ladies. Please follow them if you haven't already. But again, I want to thank everybody who's been part of this, whether you were just, you know, viewing, if you were commenting, whether you were in the boxes, as they say. I want to thank all of you. Honestly, you all made my day. I had to talk about slavery for 3 hours a day, and that was taxing my soul.
Can anyone like recommend
anything
that's not trauma?
I'm sorry.
Recommend us to like view something that's not in a trauma lens. I don't know if we can find it, but it would be nice to be able to talk about movies that are not necessarily Black trauma field that you know, like they love for us to watch. I don't know what they exist. I know In Focus said that she does film. If there is, you can also ask the audience if there are non-trauma filled movies. I think that would be great too, because a lot of people are tired of just Black trauma films.
Yeah, because I'm not going to do one. I did one before on Tales from the Hood, even though, I mean, because we were talking about horror. What was the other one? I definitely, it'll be a while before I talk about Antebellum again on this app.
First of all,
Don't start.
Jesus.
We'll be here all night with that one.
Now I feel like I need to watch it.
No. Spare yourself.
No,
you don't have to.
No.
Antebellum, you don't necessarily have to. That was a little much, but that's what I mean. Like, it would be nice if we can talk about Blackness from not a trauma-filled lens, that we can talk about what our progression of liberation would look like outside of that.
I'll think of some stuff, and I'll put some, actually, let me go ahead and start writing them. So, non-trauma, because that kills about 5 to 7 movies. I was already thinking about narrowing it down to the 5.
If you need some recommendations too for smaller films, I got you. Like, I can hit up your inbox and throw some in there, because I've been doing some deep diving on those, and they are out there. They just tend to be like smaller ones.
There's some sci-fi too.
Because I think Black people need to imagine what we would look like outside of our trauma. And I don't think we have the room and capacity to look for that. Like, if all the white people disappeared and the aliens took them today, what would we look like? You know, how will we operate as a society? And if we can start to imagine or have those progressive conversations, even if it's not necessarily like slavery trauma and all of that, like, what does our internal community issues look like that we need to get together when we become liberated? We don't take our oppressors type of tactics with us.
Right.
Films that gives us that type of conversation, right? I would love to be a part of that.
And trauma, because I'm like, lean on me, trauma.
See, I think also, I'll say this, there's a difference between trauma porn and films that actually deal with trauma. I don't think there's necessarily anything wrong with having trauma in film, because if you look at it, every film has some type of trauma in it, but they're allowed to resolve it in some way, shape, or form. Our problems stem from the fact that we have trauma porn films that have no real resolution.
Yeah, because even now I'm thinking about White Man's Burden with
that's no. Yeah, like, I just need to see a film, if can recommend it, what
our internal traumas look like and how we resolve it. Because right now, I feel like most of our films, even if we do They Clone Tyrone, right? That was on a still a white supremacy level. Okay, fine. Let's say we eliminate white supremacy. We still are dealing with the traumas of what we have adopted from our oppressors. We are still dealing with Black women dying at the hands of Black men at like astronomical rates, right? We're still dealing with homophobia and colorism. What does our conversations look like that we have not compromised our morality and our spirituality and all these other things where we're not divisive to each other? That is the conversation I would love for us to start having. And I don't think the films that we have seen have represented that. Like, and I would love to watch that and then talk about that.
Karma. You know what I mean? Karma. So nice. Neptune Frost. Watch that. You can watch on Amazon Prime.
Okay.
I believe they had it free, but they have it like if it's paid for, it's like $11, but it's worth it. It is a Afrofuturistic film that deals with technology and what it looks like for communal resolve outside of oppression. So yes, there is an aspect of like, you know, technological surveillance. What does it look like to be, you know, a lot of the conflict that happens within the continent of Africa, but it's taken from the lens of, it's actually taken from a Black queer lens, which makes it a lot more revolutionary, and it covers gender, race, transness, queerness, gender equality, and Blackness with technology and creativity.
I love that.
Thank you so much, because that's what I feel like we need to have. I think we all as a community can agree that white supremacy has damaged us in more ways than one. But if we have eliminated that, I do not feel that our community would thrive in a way that we think it would, because we have been 450 years under our oppressor. And there is a lot of Black people who want proximity to privilege, but not liberation. They want the privilege to do the same thing as their oppressor. Right. And if we don't have, and we can't figure out where to get on Zoom to have internal conversations as Black people about what will we look like and what will we do? Will we have a Christianity versus African spirituality war? What will it look like for us? Because every day on TikTok, it's a polarizing Black community in different subsects, right? We have Black women versus Black men podcasts. We've got African spirituality versus Christianity. We have all of these like mental health, whether it's real or whether or not you can just have a diet and be vegan and it goes away or pray away. We have all of these different layers that we never can discuss because we're so focused on only white supremacy. But I would love to just continue the conversation to make sure we're unified, to know that pro-Blackness means you made space for all of the people and all of their identities, intersectionalities, and ideas, and not us being pinned against each other due to intersectionality. Yeah. Intersectionality is not here for us to be divided, but for us to understand that if we look at trans women on that level and we understand their oppressions, it helps everyone. But we aren't there yet. You get what I mean? Like, if you always look at the bottom level of oppression, who's suffering the most? If you can tackle that, it then benefits everyone. But we not there yet. And so, like, I just want to make sure we make space to say, are we having those conversations as a community outside of trauma, right, of white supremacy, to say that we're going to be on the same page when we fight and get to the end of it, that we're not fighting against each other in that type of realm where we're dividing each other up off of what your sexuality, gender, and things are, right? Because we know that internal conflict happens within race communities. But unfortunately for us, we never had that luxury where we've not been Black. We've always had to fight just being Black. But if that was not an issue, what would our issues look like? And we need to have those conversations and reconciliation conversations with each other.
I think that's a good point that's being made where we can stop this. I'll stop the live because I just realized it's almost 8 o'clock. So I gotta say goodnight to my kid. What I will do is, like I said, I'll go ahead and make that video, probably not tonight, but probably tomorrow morning, saying, hey, we're going to do another live. If you missed it, blah, blah, blah. It's going to be this film. I'm sorry, this film from the options that you guys put down in the thing. So I think taking a break from Black Trauma would be a good one, because, again, this is more about discussing the history surrounding those films, social issues, cultural issues, and political issues. Depending on what's picked, it may be completely different. But I've got a long list of films that fall within the historical realm that we can discuss these issues that are brought up. So I want to thank all of you for participating. I want to thank all of you for, whether you were participating in the discussion, whether you're participating as far as the commentary, or just watching. I will go ahead and make a new event for next week. It'll just be the same thing as before. You can register and jump in, and hopefully this time still works well for everybody. But if we need to change things in the future, we'll change things in the future. But again, I want to thank all of you, and definitely thank you for pulling me out of retirement for the.
And make sure you record it, because people keep saying I came in and I missed the conversation. So as a millennial, we need you to record your live so that we can watch it on replay.
I need to download it once it's all, because I haven't saved one of these in a while, but I'm going to download it when it's done and then upload it and hopefully have it up on YouTube or something like that. But I'll of course put the information.
Thank you so much.
But no, thank you all. Everybody have a good night. Baby is beautiful.
I know, so sweet.
She's almost 4 months old, guys. I'm really excited about it.
This is your
baby.
Oh, she's adorable.
Thank you for having this, Professor, as a safe space. We really appreciate it.
No, I appreciate you guys being here. Thank you.
This is great.
I'll make that video, and of course, we'll see each other next week. Bring some more folks when we talk about, spreading or talking about everybody's projects, what they're doing. Send this out. More people have some other different ideas about other stuff that's going on besides the film festivals, book festivals, writer festivals, things like that, because everybody can contribute. Everybody can do something. But anyway, thank you, everybody. Have a good night. And hopefully the rest of the week is good for you. But good night, everybody.
Good night.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.